On Point is a production of WBUR Boston and NPR.
From WBUR Boston, I'm Tom Ashbrook, and this is On Point. For years, humans went after whales with every tool and weapon they had. They dragged the Leviathan from the seas and turned it into light, heat, shirt collars, margarine. In the 20th century, something changed. Humans went from slaughtering to revering whales. Historian D. Graham Burnett tells that story. This hour on Point, learning the whales and ourselves. You can join the conversation. What's the whale stand for to you today? We're at 1-800-423-8255. That's 800-423-TALK. Here's a little bit recorded. This is 1997, sound of a humpback whale singing, in this case in the North Atlantic. You can also join the conversation today at our website, onpointradio.org, or on Twitter and Facebook at On Point Radio. Joining me now from Princeton, New Jersey, is D. Graham Burnett, science historian and professor of history at Princeton University. He's made a great study of the scientific history of whales and whale-human interaction. His new book is The Sounding of the Whale, Science and Cetaceans in the 20th Century. D. Graham Burnett, thank you very much for joining us.
Hey, Tom. Thank you. It's a pleasure.
This is a remarkable piece of work, looking not only at the history of whaling and the scientific investigation of whales, but more fundamentally at the sort of changing human understanding of and relationship with whales over the course of a century. Just put the tent pegs, if you would, sort of at the beginning and end of that century's change. How did humans think about the great whales a century ago? And then at the end of the period you're looking at, we'll look at how it happened, but what was the change?
Well, you'd be hard-pressed to pick a taxon, a group of animals, that saw a more dramatic reimagining across the 20th century than the cetaceans, whales and dolphins. Across that 100 years, these animals go from being thought of as sort of monstrous, wallowing kegs of fat, industrial resources at best, to soulful, musical friends of humanity, bellwethers of human environmental irresponsibility, totems of the counterculture in the age of Aquarius. So you go from mindless beast to alien familiar of human beings and possibly even our intellectual and spiritual rivals across the century. And those really were the endpoints of my study. I wanted to try to understand how that happened.
That's a pretty remarkable piece of evolution right there. And you look very deeply at the whale and the interactions, but you're also very deliberately tracking something about human beings here. Almost a study of humans. Somehow it turns around before you're done with this, and it's humans learning about themselves through the way they interacted with whales over that century. What about that?
Yeah, it's exactly true. I mean, this is not just a cultural history. It is a cultural history. Mm-hmm. That is, I'm interested in ideas, imaginings, fantasies of these organisms. But I'm interested in getting at that by studying what we knew or know. I'm interested in examining the history of science of these animals. And it is always a question of self-knowledge that's at stake when one talks about science and our knowledge of nature. So the really dramatic period of that reimagining occurs in the 1950s, 1960s, and signally in the 1970s. As we hear those sounds with which you've kicked off our hour, and those sounds, which it's important to note, had been recorded by U.S. military listening stations underwater dating back to World War II. When those sounds start to be reheard as expressions of some kind of mysterious intelligence, as song, as communicative, we start to think about who we are and who we are in relation to these large-brained creatures in the sea in some very peculiar ways.
Let's hear a little more of that. Deep moans here. North Atlantic right whale. This is just off Martha's Vineyard in Massachusetts. Sound here from the Woods Hole Oceanographic Institution. It's hard not to think a little bit cosmic. It almost sounds like Tibetan monks doing, you know, the Tuvan throat singers or something there.
Right.
The technology captured that. But I want to ask you, say, this contemporary reimagining. Of course, if you look back further, the Leviathan is a symbol of something great and deep, is right there in ancient religious texts. I mean, you've got Jonah and the whale, and even just in the 19th century, you've got Moby Dick and the great white whale. It's not as though they were seen as strictly, you know, tons of flesh.
No, it's true. It's true. And you may know that in 2007, I published a book called Trying Leviathan, which reaches back to the period before the 20th century and takes up some of that earlier history of the whale and our imaginings. But what happens in the 20th century is very particular. You know, listeners who have only a passing knowledge of the history of whaling are probably unaware that there's a radical distinction between pre-19th century, you know, pre-20th century whaling and 20th century whaling. You think whaling, you think, especially in New England, open boat, guys rowing.
Harpoon. Hurled by a strong arm.
Cold steel and salt spray. Mm-hmm. That whole fishery, as we say, predates the 20th century. It was conducted under sail, and it was conducted almost exclusively for sperm whales, right whales, bowhead whales.
Whales of a size that could be pulled in by men in a small boat.
Yes, and significantly, whales that had a fat to muscle ratio such that they would, after being killed, sit up quite high in the water, float.
Mm-hmm.
And also species that are comparatively slow swimmers. The 20th century industry begins right around 1900, a little bit before in Scandinavia. And it is industrial, meaning it is steam or diesel-driven catcher vessels firing explosive-tipped, you know, grenade harpoons from howitzer-like cannons on the bow. And ultimately, that fishery pursues the rorqual whales.
These are the really swimming, huge ones.
Yes, and much faster swimming, so blue whales, fin whales, and pursues them starting in the 20th century around the Antarctic convergence, so around the coldest and most forbidding waters of the southern hemisphere, where the vast majority, the bulk of the cetacean biomass of the oceans lived. That industry is not about the sort of homey illumination.
Scrimshaw carving guys at sea with ditties.
This is ripping apart very big animals very quickly and dropping them down into steam cookers, granulating the organic remains of meat and bone into fertilizer additives and protein supplements for feedstock, and draining off the high-grade oil, as you said, for, amazingly, hydrogenation and use in butter substitutes, margarine, primarily in Europe, and then saponification fat used for soap production. Amazingly, in the period around World War I, this is one of these strange facts in the history of whales and science, one of the primary drives for the industry was not soap, but the byproduct of saponification, glycerin, which of course was a crucial ingredient in nitroglycerin for the war effort. So development of smokeless powders in the 1930s shifts that.
But military right application.
Military application, such a strange thing to think about. So I say all that to distinguish, to go back to the question, to distinguish the earlier history of both human-whale relations and the earlier history of whaling from what happens across the 20th century, which is colored very differently because of this industrial push and the extraordinary size of the industry and the scope of the destruction that's wreaked on these populations.
That sets us up very well after a short break coming up right here to look at what happened in that century in this extreme swing from the most gruesome mass-scale kind of factory fishing or whaling that D. Graham Burnett describes in his new book, The Sounding of the Whale, from that to the sort of whale as icon of almost mystic spirituality, intelligence, Age of Aquarius practically, and little Cold War technology application and research right in the middle of that. We'll come back and look at all that. Here's a eastern North Atlantic here, the fin whale. You can hear the low pulses here, usually nearly inaudible to the human ear, recorded by Sosus here. Sounds that we've all come to know in this century as our understanding of the whale has really changed. D. Graham Burnett traces that. You can join the conversation today. What's the whale stand for to you now? Can you see in the history of whaling how different the human understanding once was? What do changing perceptions of whales and their significance tell us about ourselves? We're at 800-423-8255, 800-423-TALK. Here's the Greenland Whale Fisheries. I'm Tom Ashbrook. This is On Point. We'll be right back.
Now the boats were launched, the men aboard, and the whale was in full view. Resolve it was, each seaman bold, to steer where the whale fish blew. Brave boys, to steer where the whale fish blew. Oh, we struck that whale and the line played out, but she gave a flourish with her tail, and the boat capsized and four men were drowned. We never caught that whale, brave boys, we never caught that whale. To lose the men, the captain cried, it grieves my heart full sore. But oh, to lose 100-barrel whale, it grieves me 10 times more, brave boys. It grieves me 10 times more.
I'm Tom Ashbrook. This is On Point. We're talking this hour about whales and how we think about them, how they went from factory ship fodder, units of oil, to revered icons of nature and deep-sea intelligence. Behind us right there, the Arctic-toothed whale, the narwhal, recorded in 97 by the American and Canadian Frémeaux Heritage. You can join the conversation this hour. What do you think? How do you think about whales today and what they stand for? And what do changing perceptions of whales and their significance tell us about ourselves? Did we underestimate whales back in the day when they were just slaughtered? Do we overestimate them today when they're revered? Or are we finally getting it just right? D. Graham Burnett joins us, science historian, professor of history at Princeton University, out with a tremendous new study, and weighty at that, but really goes deep on the 20th century whaling industry and whale research and the turn in perception at the heart of it. The book is The Sounding of the Whale, Science and Cetaceans in the 20th Century. I should say, to see a photo gallery of 20th century whaling and whale research, go to our website at onpointradio.org. He joins us today from Princeton, New Jersey, and this is really quite a piece of work. Give us a sense, if you would, just the scale of that factory fishing, factory whaling. And this, and to begin with, was not so much on boats, so I guess it was always both, but also this island that you have gathered images of. Was it Prince George, St. George? Of the Antarctic, just an unbelievable sea of blood. What volume of whales being brought in here?
Yes. I mean, the emergence of the industry in the southern hemisphere in the early 20th century was like a gold rush. So South Georgia is the primary
South Georgia,
island.
That's it. Mm-hmm.
An island about the size of Long Island, nestled right on the cusp of what's called the Antarctic Convergence, an area of very rich upwelling, large plankton blooms, and a region to which huge numbers of whales came in the southern hemisphere summer to feed. And I suppose one could hardly do better to give a feeling for the scope of this hunt in the early years than to describe the conditions on a neighboring island, Deception Island,
okay,
a little farther south. Deception Island was a part of a volcanic archipelago. So it actually has hydrothermal vents at the center of a ring-shaped island form. And it was a place to which a number of the early factory vessels repaired because the calmer water conditions in this large harbor were ideal for processing. And in the early years of the industry, there was such a greedy, mad rush for profit. Mm. Some of the companies were paying dividends on investment of over 250% on an annual basis. So there were such riches to be made that the whalemen tended to process only the blubber layer of the animals. So they would basically peel that external layer off and melt that down. Wouldn't treat the actual carcass at all. So it's like skimming the cream and throwing away the milk because, of course, the carcass itself has all kinds of – if you're going to kill the animals and you want to process them, you might as well process the whole thing. Well, they didn't early on. But what did this mean? It meant that after 10 years of having multiple factory vessels working in this small closed harbor with this relatively warm water, one couldn't walk on the shore of the inside of the harbor on the downwind side because the organic residue of the thousands and thousands of rotting carcasses of animals that piled up in this harbor left a 14 feet. It was so deep on that harbor that you couldn't walk because you would sink in over your head and be lost there in what was a kind of flocculent cheese made of a decade's worth of dead animals. So it was a region, it just unspeakable. And the men who worked those factories, vessels, and those shore stations were in many cases broken by the scale, the enormity, and the kind of obscene character of the work. I mean, there were men who were seriously injured, reportedly even killed, by the forcible ejection of a unborn fetus from one of the female animals pulled up onto the flensing plan.
Because the whales would rot and kind of explode often with the whatever inside come just blowing out as they
the
waited
gases,
for processing.
Mm-hmm. That's right. The gases, autolysis, internal digestion of the body, especially given the heat of the animals that would develop because of their blubber layer, really seriously grotesque. And part of what I take up in the book, I mean, the reason I tell these macabre stories is I'm especially interested in the first set of biologists, scientists, who went to these regions to begin to try to make sense of these animals, to answer some basic questions about whether this hunt was sustainable, to answer basic questions about the physiology, reproductive cycles, and life
because
history.
Because for the first time, because of this kind of whaling, they had access to the whales, but it also made them kind of allies of the whaling industry that was slaughtering.
This is the perversity that lies behind the story. You're absolutely right on the first part. Scientists, men of learning, natural philosophers have had a devil of a time getting access to whales. They are fugitive, furtive, mysterious creatures and part of the kind of mysterious overriding of the animal across the early modern period has something to do with just it was hard to get them. You only found one when it washed up on the beach basically. Mm-hmm. Well, in the 20th century, it was suddenly an embarrassment of riches for these biologists. If they made it to South Georgia or Deception Island, they had hundreds of whales in any given month, thousands across a season to study, and they used statistical techniques that were, you know, novel because they had such massive amounts of data, but physically on them, psychologically on them, to try to study life, biology, the study of life, in what has to have been one of the truly smoldering cauldrons of death. It tested them. It tested them, and it killed a number of them. It was a serious business.
You write not until 1963 did world production of whale oil outside the Antarctic exceed that from Antarctic waters. That I didn't have that image in my mind, reversing the pattern that was established back in 1910. And you say, by that time, the majority of the Earth's cetacean biomass, mainly whales, had been immolated, was gone. What volume was taken out of the seas? Did we ever really come to understand what percentage was gone, taken?
My understanding, I think, Thomas, we'll have Joe Roman talking with us a little bit later.
We will.
He's especially good on these kinds of questions. Mm-hmm. He's one of the scientists who's really tried to plumb in a technical way exact measures of how much damage we did to these stocks, a question which remains controversial. So I'd be hard-pressed to put a kind of a number on it. Millions of whales, certainly that. But what is especially of interest to me in the book is to try to study how people tried to answer that very question across the sort of 50 years in the middle of the 20th century. So everybody wanted to know, can we keep doing this?
Mm-hmm.
And the whalemen wanted to know it as much as anyone else, because if they were going to catch out the population, commercial extinction, they wanted to know when it was going to happen so that they could put their investments into something else. But how do you answer that question? Figuring out what a sustainable catch was tested population biologists, statisticians, and zoologically oriented biologists in a lot of complicated ways across that sort of 50-year period.
Part of tapping the brakes on that pace of whaling came from some pretty amazing changes in perception of the whale, and some of those changes came from some pretty amazing quarters. You write about John C. Lilly, who I guess no small part of his work came out of Cold War military bioscience. Controversial guy, but had a lot to do with the sort of phase change or perception shift that became so popular later. Who was he, and how did he get engaged here?
So part of the argument of the book is that there's no character who's more important to understand if you want to make sense of that shift with which we kicked off the show, namely the shift from soulless, mindless beast to soulful, musical friend of humanity.
Mm-hmm.
I would argue that the linchpin figure is John Lilly. So who was he? He was a pioneering neurophysiologist, so a kind of brain scientist, mm-hmm. trained in medicine, most of whose early research work was on macaques, on monkeys,
mm-hmm.
for the National Institutes of Mental Health. He was on the edges of the sort of Manchurian candidate era sciences of mind and behavior, meaning he was one of these guys who was trying to figure out how you get access to the inner life of a recalcitrant character, a recalcitrant mm-hmm. and possibly oppositional figure.
Maybe a Cold War spy.
For instance.
Mm-hmm.
And so the work that he did on cortical mapping, so mapping the brain, and on sort of inserting electrodes into the brain, delivering little charges in order to kind of study pain centers, for instance. There were a fair number of spooks hanging around the edges of his laboratories with an interest in these kinds of activities. Around about 1955, he made a trip down to Marine Studios in Florida and got his hands on a couple of Tursiops truncatus, bottlenose dolphin.
Mm-hmm.
And it made a considerable impression on him to discover how large their brains were, much larger than the macaques on which he'd mm-hmm. been working. And he began to do some of the kinds of experiments he'd been doing on macaques on those tursiops. Not good for the dolphins, I'm afraid.
Because it included psychedelics.
Well, we get there. Mm-hmm. By the early 1960s, it's true that he's using LSD-25 on the dolphins. He's using it
Why?
At that point on himself. Well, he is a kind of Leary figure.
As in Timothy Leary.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, tunes in, turns on, and to some extent drops out. So across the watershed, 58 to 65, he goes from being a kind of crop-haired guy with a pocket protector doing a fair bit of Cold War-type science to being a kind of Pied Piper guru of reawakened consciousness. Now, that's a complicated story. It's chapter 6 in the mm-hmm. book. We can perhaps summarize it this way.
Mm-hmm, yes, please, because he brings in this sort of cosmic mystic element or revives it from ancient days, but in a very what ultimately 1960s kind of envelope.
Yes, although he's in part inventing the 1960s, even as he does that. So, how do you end up giving LSD to dolphins? Well, it's important to remember LSD was one of the products in the toolkit of those Manchurian era, those Manchurian candidate era scientists.
They gave it to humans trying to figure out mind behavior. Mm-hmm.
They sure did, and they did it in part to decrease inhibition when you were doing, say, psychotherapy. And guys in the CIA gave it to each other. They mickeyed each other in an effort to see what kinds of things an agent would be likely to reveal if his inhibitions were suitably lowered by ending up under the influence. So it's to say that it was being used in veterans' hospitals to treat people with sort of what we now think of as post-traumatic stress disorders. And Lilly had access to it through his military work. And because he believed that there was an intelligence inside those dolphin heads, mm-hmm. he eventually used all the techniques in his toolkit to try to get access to it, and LSD was one of them. Now, he gave it to himself at the same time, in part because he wanted to commensurate his intelligence with theirs, and in part because he came to believe that the real hurdle to accessing dolphin intelligence was less dolphin recalcitrance than the human inability to think our way in to mm-hmm. these extraordinary intelligences. But the story is mighty strange, because one of the other elements of that toolkit that Lilly used in the 1950s back at NIMH, the National Institutes of Mental Health, was the flotation tank.
Sensory deprivation.
Exactly. So you might drop, future submarine pilot or a future astronaut into one of these sensory deprivation chambers or tanks in order to figure out whether he could keep his mind intact across, say, 12 to 25 hours of getting no input. Lilly kind of liked that scenario. He liked floating in those tanks, and he believed it did allow him to access something about his own mind. He takes that tank with him when he sets up his laboratory to study dolphins, and he comes to believe that by hanging out in it himself, he's kind of feeling what it's like to be a brain in a vat, which is what he comes to think of a dolphin being in certain ways. So he sets up his headphones, links up to the hydrophones in the dolphin tank, sets himself floating, takes a little LSD, and tries to think his way into a dolphin consciousness. It seems by that point sort of comically 1960s, except what one has to remember is that much of this work is being funded by the military. Mm-hmm. Being funded by the military. Why? Well, Lilly was successful in selling the Navy and the Air Force and NASA on the idea that dolphins could serve as model organisms in our efforts to understand how to break through to an alien intelligence. NASA. In other words, since we might encounter extraterrestrials, we would need to figure out how we would go about communicating with them. Why wouldn't we start to develop a model for how to do that by studying communication with another large-brained organism here on Earth? And so Lilly ends up buddies with Carl Sagan, the SETI program, the Search for Extraterrestrial Intelligence. And at this point, you know, it is starting to feel like very heady 1960s. Once his funders find out about the LSD, once his stream of publications isn't quite as – his peer-reviewed publications not quite as rich as they were hoping, they cut off his funding. And the military's program goes down, and Lilly heads off to the West Coast down a very different path.
And meanwhile, I mean, maybe it's not so crazy, the idea of thinking about dolphin consciousness to pop human consciousness out of the deep bloody hole we had been in earlier in the 20th century, just slaughtering those whales. D. Graham Burnett, please stand by in Princeton, New Jersey, author of The Sounding of the Whale, Science and Cetaceans in the 20th Century. When we come back, marine ecologist Joe Roman joins us. He spent a lot of time right out there with the whales. Listeners, can you see the arc of human comprehension of the whale and how it changed in one century? 800-423-8255. I'm Tom Ashbrook. This is On Point. We'll be right back.
And now we are all gone, there'll be no more hunting. The big fellow is no more, and it's no use lamenting.
What race will be next in line? All for the slaughter. I am the last of the great whales, and I am dying.
I'm Tom Ashbrook. This is On Point, and we're talking today about whales and how we think about them, how they went from factory ship fodder units of oil to revered icons of nature and deep-sea intelligence. Behind us there, whale song from the East Australian humpback whale. This was recorded by the Oceana Project in 1999. D. Graham Burnett is with us today. His big new book on whales and those who chased and hunted and studied them and changing perceptions of whales is The Sounding of the Whale, Science and Cetaceans in the 20th Century. It began with massive, massive whaling, really centered in that time in the Antarctic. It moved into very tough encounters between environmentalists and whalers. Here's a little bit from the first season of Animal Planet's documentary TV show Whale Wars, a clip of the Japanese whaling ship Nishin Maru fighting as conservationists aboard the ship Sea Shepherd attempt to herd the Japanese ship back into Japanese waters. Sea Shepherd deckhand Lorenz de Groot is talking first here.
He's aiming straight at us and he's throwing flashbangs.
You can see it gets pretty hairy there as perceptions change and environmentalists meet whalers there in that clip. D. Graham Burnett joins us from Princeton, New Jersey. We've got lots of response online. Rye says, for me, a whale represents the notion that the Earth exists at a superhuman scale. To see a whale, to imagine the whale as we hear it sing, is a humbling experience. Eric writes on Facebook, whaling is a horrifying crime. What kind of monster could butcher these enormous, beautiful, sacred, intelligent animals? Kind of lining up the descriptors, Graham Burnett, that you find emerged exactly in the 20th century. Sarah reminds us on Facebook. She says she's not comfortable with this characterization of this as a transformation in human perceptions of whales. And that's me speaking too broadly. She says, surely you're speaking to a cultural phenomenon, and the we is not all-inclusive. There have long been other cultural understandings of whales and whaling, notably among peoples who have depended on whales as a primary food source. I want to look at that, and we'll be joined in just a moment by marine ecologist Joe Roman. But let's bring our listeners in. Molly in Lexington, Kentucky. Molly, thanks for calling. You're on the air.
Thank you. I just had a question for the professor. I love whales. I went on a whale-watching trip to Massachusetts, and it was like a life-changing spiritual event, blah, blah, blah. But I lived in Korea for a year, and seeing the difference over there about how a lot of Asian cultures think about whales, like whale wars with Japan and Korea that still hunt whales for, you know, food mm-hmm. and whatever else. And I was just wondering why in, like, Western cultures, we've sort of accepted the whale as, like, you know, sort of like horses, as an animal that is not to be eaten. It has a spiritual significance. But in Asian countries, it doesn't seem like they have yet.
Molly, let us pick it up. D. Graham Burnett, there's Sarah on online and Molly on the air asking about cultural distinctions and where they stood, where they stand. How do you look at that range of angles on the whale?
It's such a – I mean, it's so terrific to hear, you know, your listeners putting their finger on such an important refinement of what we've been talking about so far, because it's absolutely true. Mm-hmm. Now, it's also a little complicated. Less well known is the extent to which the United States itself played a very important role in stimulating Japanese interest in and appetite for whaling.
I thought it was time immemorial, the thing that was done out of Japan.
There's an element of invented tradition there, it has to be said. It was General MacArthur himself and Supreme Allied Command facing a Japanese population in very serious nutritional deficit at the end of World War II mm-hmm. that played an active role in restarting a serious Japanese commercial whaling enterprise after the war. And the kind of Japanese consumption of whale was pushed very hard by the U.S. as a protein supplement in a period where things were very destabilized. So now I don't mean to suggest, and listeners shouldn't mishear me, yes, people in Japan have eaten whale going back a long time. Mm-hmm. And it's absolutely true that people in a number of indigenous cultures around the world have done so. And in Scandinavia, there are considerable traditions this way too. And yet, there is, even in those places, less kind of timeless tradition than specific histories that need to be addressed. Why, and this is the question that floats all over all of this, do these remarkable transformations in attitude happen as they do in Western Europe and in the United States, and not in the Soviet Union and in Japan, not to some extent in Norway as well? Well, that you really, that's the book in a lot of ways. Mm-hmm. It's about that. But it is in part a story about some pretty local politics in many cases. The whole middle of the book deals with the emergence of the International Whaling Commission,
right,
the intergovernmental body that is supposed to regulate the industry and protect the animals, which arises right after World War II. And that's really where you see the sort of diplomatic, geopolitical questions intersect with these cultural questions. And science remains at the heart of it, because you have to build population models that'll tell you how many of the animals you can kill at any given time.
Let's check in with one of those scientists for just a moment, if we could, right here. D. Graham Burnett's new book is The Sounding of the Whale. With us right now from New York is Joe Roman, marine ecologist, conservation biologist, professor at the University of Vermont's Rubenstein School for the Environment and Natural Resources. He has tracked whales all over the place. Today he's with the Natural Resources Defense Council, assessing populations of marine mammals in the U.S. He's author of Listed and Whale. Joe Roman, thank you very much for being with us today.
Thank you, Tom, and hi, Graham.
Hey.
It's good to have both of you with us. Joe, D. Graham Burnett sort of bows to you when it comes to thinking about how much of the cetacean population of the planet we lost in let's say, the 20th century. Have we ever figured that out?
Well, I don't think we have a handle on every species, but keep in mind, like Graham was talking about, in the 1950s and 1960s, we know we were removing at least 50, 60,000 animals out of the water each year, an incredible number. And keep in mind, for a lot of species like blue whales, they were already depleted. The same story as for that southern hemisphere, where blue whales were brought to numbers that are close to 1% of their historical numbers, are also true for the North Pacific and the North Atlantic. Humpback whales, for example, at less than 10% of their historical numbers. That's research that we did using DNA.
But were you saying 99% then, in effect, taken out of those waters, of those populations?
For blue whales, that's right, and they're
wow.
still at those low numbers. We thought that they might start rebounding after they've been protected since the late 1960s. Those populations are still small, and we're not sure why. It might be because actually the role that the whales were playing in the ecosystem, that is, they dive deep to feed, they come to the surface, and they're releasing nutrients. By taking the whales out of the system, we've changed the ecosystem so much that it's going to be difficult for some species to come back.
For a long time, that was not well understood, the role that these top predators would play. It's still kind of hard to see. We think about plankton and sort of stuff that's all over the place, fish and the smaller organisms. But what is that role that the whale plays or played that was so important as that huge top predator?
That's right. Historically, I think it was enormous, and we can think of several ways. One would be, as I just mentioned, they would be increasing primary productivity by diving deep in the very nutrient-rich waters, coming to the surface where they defecate and actually increase the amount of plankton or algae in the water.
So they'd be moving nutrients around the sea and be numerous enough to do that on a scale that mattered.
Exactly. When the numbers were high enough, this would have been ecologically important. And it still is now, mm-hmm. by the way. It's just, of course, a lot smaller. There are still enough whales to make this difference. They were also important when they died. When whales die, they sink as these large carcasses, bringing lots of nutrients into systems that are very nutrient poor, the deep sea. entire communities have evolved that were dependent on those whales. My colleague Craig Smith thinks this may have been some of the earliest extinctions of the sea. Species went extinct before we even discovered them because we removed that habitat out of the system.
Species that depended on whale carcasses sinking down through the sea. I mean, you're saying that far from just being a kind of ornament on the oceans, grand as they may be, in many ways, whales at their full population ran the ocean life.
That's right. We think of them as drivers of the ocean ecosystem. And we're seeing that for lots of species now. We know it's true even for terrestrial species. And it's a long time coming for us to recognize that for whales. They're drivers of the ecosystems. And keep in mind, they're still drivers of lots of economies around the world through whale watching. It's still a multi-billion dollar business, whales, an industry, but it's an industry that's out to look at the whales rather than to kill them.
Joe Roman, when you give us these numbers, in some species and waters, 99% of these great creatures, whales, out of the waters, we can see just how aggressive the human approach was and how they could just be seen as animal food or stuff to be, you know, hydrogenated into margarine. But what do you think now at the other end of this century, where they're put on such a pedestal as a direct researcher, when people talk about their intelligence, their sort of a super cosmic presence, do you roll your eyes at that, Joe, or do you give that some kind of credence? Are you just happy if it protects them?
I'm happy if it protects them, but sometimes we do talk among ourselves that they're kind of just glorious cows. At least some species are. They're grazers. They're out there mowing the lawn for a living. That being said, also keep in mind we also see them as gentle giants, but they can be very aggressive, and they are incredibly effective predators. Just like we see predators on land, think of the bull orca whales, a predator that can kill a 40-ton animal, another whale, with no problem. They are gentle giants, and they're beautiful to look at, but it's much more complicated. A friend of mine, Mason Weinrich, likes to tell the story that we often think of whales as cooperating, but now that we're starting to peer beneath the sea with tags that enable us to see what whales are doing under the water, we're finding that a lot of times one whale will be doing all the work, another one will come in and mooch out of that bubble net that it's creating. Mm-hmm. So it's far more complicated than that.
D. Graham Burnett, how do you look at the swing in human understanding over this century, or let's say in our culture's understanding, if that's a better way, as Sarah says, to put it? Has it gone to some sort of cosmic silliness, or is that really appropriate for the grandeur of these creatures, or do you see glorious cows?
Well, at the beginning of this session of the show, you played that clip from current Whale Wars stuff, and, you know, those confrontations, each of them now, popular as they are on television, they reenact a classic 1975 Greenpeace encounter with the Soviet whalers.
Yes,
in the Mendocino Ridge.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
It's an amazing episode and a watershed moment in the history of conservation, because you had these long-haired radicals confronting the cannons and sort of throwing themselves in their zodiacs in front of the whales. And, you know, that kind of projected, I would argue to an extent, fantasy, imagining, has a lot to do with our desire to transcend ourselves. The idea that these animals are our alien familiars, intelligent like we are, especially dolphins, but almost more so sperm whales, which are out of that category of lawn mowing cow animals. These are serious predators.
Right.
Those animals with their giant brains, there is a sense that these animals are like us, only more so. And this was a John Lilly fascination, and it got entangled with the Vietnam War era hawks and doves kind of conflict, in part because the U.S. did begin using dolphins in the military, as some people will know, and in part because some figures like Lilly kind of crossed over the watershed, having been involved with the military, to begin saying, we must turn against this culture of violence. There's just one story about that that's worth telling. Mm. There was a fantasy, a projected fantasy, that these were super intelligent animals without hands. And because they didn't have hands, they didn't evolve their intelligence in the direction of kind of manipulative violence.
Okay.
but instead evolved their intelligence in the direction of a kind of pure being. Mm-hmm. And that was one of the ways that in the 1960s and 70s, they were conceived as sort of the optimal ideal of a kind of super intelligent, pacifistic organism.
Amazing swing in the space of a century. Let me get one more call. John in Franconia, New Hampshire. John, you're on the air.
Hi, John. Thank
Hi.
You. I'd like to bring to the awareness, you had Sarah earlier that mentioned that the Eastern or Asian tendency to still hunt whales, the Icelandics and the Norwegians still hunt whales too.
Yes, yes, indeed.
So it's not just an Eastern culture that's happening with hunting these whales. And I kayak with all kinds of whales up on the Saguenay Fjord in the St. Lawrence River, 4 hours north of Quebec City.
Mm-hmm.
I get into a boat that's less than 18 feet long and 4 inches from the water. And I've been in with blue whales that have been 90 feet long, humpbacks, finbacks, minkies, belugas. And I'm convinced of their intelligence. I'm convinced of their being such a civil creature. They have the ability to create havoc or harm, and yet they choose not to, and they're very curious. They'll come up to your kayak and actually look above the water and see what you're doing. And just one other thing I'd like to put out there is that in even our continent, we're still destroying these beautiful creatures because of the pollution that's in the water.
Yeah, there's the whole environmental, the toxicology of the water. John, our time grows so short, but I really appreciate that image of you in the kayak with these creatures. Joe Roman, quickly to you. Our time is short here, but what about the hunting is much reduced, but the toxic content of our oceans, is it a threat to whales now?
I think that's a very good point. There's lots of threats to whales now. Keep in mind, we are still a whaling nation. We just do it indirectly. Whales are killed all the time. In part, they're run over by ships, by ships that are going, for example, into Boston, where you are now. The good news about that is they've moved the shipping channel out of the area where a lot of the whales feed. So work done on Stellwagen Bank has helped mitigate that concern, but they're also caught in fishing lines. They're undoubtedly impacted by pollution, and a big concern is noise pollution under the sea. You started off this hour listening to those beautiful sounds.
Mm-hmm.
Before 1950, a blue whale probably could have heard another blue whale across the ocean. So silent was the sea. Nowadays, maybe 100 kilometers, 50 miles or so, as far as whales can hear each other.
Wow.
There's so much noise out there.
We've been looking at huge changes, and there's one more. Joe Roman, author of Listed in Whale. Joe, thank you so much for being with us today.
Thank you, Tom.
And D. Graham Burnett, author of The Sounding of the Whale, Science and Cetaceans in the 20th Century, a great tour on this horizon. Thank you so much, D. Graham Burnett.
A pleasure, Tom.
This is On Point.